a muse of fire that would ascend, the brightest heaven of invention, a kingdom for a stage, princes to act, and monarchs to behold the swelling scene. Then would the warlike Harry, like himself, assume the port of Mars, and at his heels, leashed in like hounds, should famine, sword, and fire crouch for employment.
But pardon, and gentles all, the flat, unraised spirits that have dared on this unworthy scaffold to bring forth so great an object. Can this cockpit hold the vasty fields of France? Or may we cram within this wooden O the very cast that did affright the air at Agincourt? Oh, pardon, since a crooked figure may attest in little place a million, and let us, ciphers to this great account, on your imaginary forces work. Suppose, within the girdle of these walls, are now confined two mighty monarchies, whose high upreared and abutting fronts, the perilous narrow ocean parts asunder.
Piece out our imperfections with your thoughts, and unto a thousand parts divide on man. Make imaginary puissance. Think that when we talk of horses, you see them, printing their proud hooves the receiving earth. For 'tis your thoughts that now must deck our kings, carrying them here and there, jumping over times, turning the accomplishments of many years into an hourglass, for the which supply, and may us course to history, who, prologue-like, your humble patience pray.
Gently to hear.
Kindly to judge.
Our play.
It must be thought on. If it pass against us, we lose the better half of our possession. This would drink deep. 'Twould drink the cup and all. The king is full of grace and fair regard, and a true lover of the Holy Church. The courses of his youth promised it not. The breath no sooner left his father's body, but that his wildness, mortified in him, seemed to die too. I have made an offer to his majesty, as touching France, to give a greater sum than ever at one time the clergy yet did to his predecessors part withal. The French ambassador, upon that instant, craved audience, and the hour, I think, is come to give him hearing.
My gracious Lord of Canterbury.
God and his angels guard your sacred throne and make you long become it.
Sure. We thank you, my learned lord. We pray you to proceed and justly and religiously unfold why the law salique that they have in France, or should not, bar us in our claim. And God forbid, my dear and faithful lord, that you should fashion, rest, or bow your reading. Therefore, take heed how you impawn our person, how you awake our sleeping sword of war. We charge you, in the name of God, take heed, for we will hear and note and believe in heart that what you say is in your mind, washed clean as sin with baptism.
Then hear me, gracious sovereign, and you peers that owe yourselves your lives and services to this imperial throne. There is no bar to make against your highness's claim to France, but this which they produce in Fairmont. No woman shall succeed in Salic land, which Salic land the French unjustly glows to be the realm of France, and Fairmont the founder of this law and female bar. Yet their own authors faithfully affirm that the land Salic is in Germany, between the floods of Sala and of Elbe. Then doth it well appear that Salic law was not devised for the realm of France. Who Capet also, who served the crown, of Charles the Duke of Lorraine, sole heir male of the true line and stock of Charles the Great, conveyed himself as heir to the Lady Dingar, daughter to Charlemagne, who is the son of Louis the Great, and Louis the son of Charles the Great. So that, as clear as a summer sun, King Pepin's title and Hugh Capet's claim, King Louis's satisfaction, all appear to hold in right and title of the female. So do the kings of France unto this day.
May I with right and conscience make this claim?
The sin upon my head, dread sovereign, for in the book of Numbers it is writ, when the man dies, let the inheritance descend unto the daughter. Gracious lord, stand for your own, unwind your bloody flag. Look back into your mighty ancestors, O noble English that could entertain, with half their forces the full pride of France, and let the other half stand laughing by, all out of work and cold for action.
Your brother kings and monarchs of this earth, do all expect that you should rouse yourself as did the former lines of your blood.
They know your grace hath cause and means and might, so hath your highness. Never king of England had nobles richer and more loyal subjects, whose hearts have left their bodies here in England and lie pavilioned in the fields of France.
Oh, let their bodies follow, my dear liege, with blood and sword and fire to win your right. In aid whereof we of the spirituality will raise a greater sum than ever did the clergy yet receive, and did their ancestors unto this day.
Call on the messengers sent from the Dauphin. Now, are we well resolved, and by God's help and yours, the noble sinews of our power, France being ours, will bend it to our awe, or break it all to pieces. Now are we well prepared to know the pleasure of our fair cousin the Dauphin, for we hear your greeting is from him, not the king.
May it please your majesty to give us leave, freely to render what we have in charge, or shall we sparingly show you far off the Dauphin's meeting and our embassy?
We are no tyrant, but a Christian king. Therefore, with frank and uncurbed plainness, tell us the Dauphin's mind.
Thus then in few, your highness lately sending into France, did claim some certain dukedoms in the right of your great predecessor, King Edward III. In answer of which claim, the king, our master, says that you savor too much of your youth. He therefore sends, meter for your spirit, this ton of treasure, and in lieu of this, desires you let the dukedoms that you claim hear no more of you. This the Dauphin speaks.
What treasure, uncle?
Tennis balls, my liege.
We are glad the Dauphin is so pleasant with us. His present and your pains we thank you for. When we have marched our rackets to these balls, we will in France, by God's grace, play a set that shall strike his father's crown into the hazard. Tell him he hath made a match with such a wrangler that all the courts of France will be disturbed with chases. And we understand him well, how he comes o'er us with our wilder days, not measuring what use we made of them. And tell the pleasant prince, this mock of his hath turned his balls to gunstones, and his soul shall stand sword charged for the wasteful vengeance that shall fly with them. For many a thousand widows shall this his mock out of their dear husbands, mock mothers from their sons, mock castles down, and some are yet ungotten and unborn that shall have cause to curse the Dauphin's scorn. So get you hence in peace, and tell the pleasant prince, this jest of his will savor but of shallow wit, when thousands weep more than did laugh at it. Convey them with safe conduct. Fare you well.
This was a merry message.
We hope to make the sender blush at it. Therefore, my lords, omit no happy hour that may give furtherance to our expedition, for we now have no thought in us but France. Therefore, let every man now task his thought that this fair action may on foot be brought.
Silken dalliances in the wardrobe lies. Now thrive the armorer's and honor's thoughts, reign solely in the breast of every man. They sell the pasture now to buy the horse, following the mirror of all Christian kings with winged heels as English Mercuries.
The French, advised by good intelligence of this most dreadful preparation, shake in their fear, and with pale policy seek to divert the English purposes. O England, model to thy inward greatness, like little body with a mighty heart, what mightst thou do that honor would thee do were all thy children kind and natural?
Well met, Corporal Nem.
Lieutenant Bartle.
What, are ancient pistol and you friends yet?
For my part, I care not. I stay little, but when time shall serve, there shall be smiles. But that shall be as it may. I dare not fight, but I will wink and hold out mine iron. It is a simple one, but what thou? It will toast cheese and will endure cold as another man's sword will. And there's an end.
I will bestow a breakfast to make you friends. It will be all three sworn brothers to France. Let it be so, good Corporal Nem.
Faith, I will live as long as I may. That's a certain of it. And when I cannot live any longer, I will do as I may. That is my rest. That is the rendezvous of it.
It is certain, Corporal, that he is married to Nell Quickly, and certainly she did you wrong, for you were troth plight to her.
I cannot tell. Things must be as they may. Men may sleep, and they may have their throats about the time, and some say knives have edges. But it shall be as it may. Though patience be a tired mare, yet she will plod. There must be conclusions. Well, I cannot tell.
Here comes Ancient Pistol and his wife, good Corporal. Be patient here. How now, mine host Pistol?
Base tyke, callest thou me host? By this hand, I swear, I scorn the term, nor shall my Nell keep lodgers.
No, by my troth, not long, for we cannot lodge and board a dozen or 14 gentle women that live honestly by the prick of their needles. Oh, well a day, lady, if he be not drawn now, we shall see woeful slander and batteries committed.
Good lieutenant, good corporal, offer nothing here.
Pish, pish for thee! Iceland dog, thou prick-eared cur of Iceland.
Good corporal Nim, show thy valor and put up your sword.
Will you shog off? I would have you so loose.
So loose, egregious dog. O viper vile, the soul's in thy most marvelous face, the soul's in thy teeth and in thy throat. I do retort the soul loose in thy bowels, for I can take, and Pistol's cock is up, and flashing fire will follow.
I'm not Barbasin. You cannot conjure me. I've the humor to knock you indifferently well. If you grow foul with me, Pistol, I will scour you with my rapier. And if you were to walk off, I would prick your guts a little, as I may, in good terms. And that's the humor of it.
Oh, braggart vile, and damn it, furious wight, the grave doth gape, and doting death is near. Therefore,
hear me what I say. He that strikes the first stroke, I'll run him up to the hilt as I am a soldier.
An oath of mickle might, and fury shall abate. Give me thy fist, thy forefoot to give me. Thy spirits are most tall.
I will cut thy throat one time or another, in fair terms, and that's the humor of it.
I thee defy again.
Thine host, Pistol, you must come to my master, and you, hostess, he is very sick and would to bed. Good Bardolph, put thy face between his sheets and do the office of a warming pan. Faith, he's very ill.
Away, you rogue!
No, by my troth, he'll yield the crow pudding one of these days. The king has killed his heart. Good husband, come home presently.
Come, shall I make you two friends? We must to France together. Why the devil should we keep knives to cut one another's throats?
Let floods or swell, and fiends for food howl on.
You'll pay me 8 shillings I want of you at betting?
Base is a slave that pays.
That now will have, and that's the humor of it.
As manhood shall compound, push home!
He that strikes the first stroke, I'll kill him with the sword, I will.
Sword is an oath, and oaths must have their courses.
Corporal Nim, and thou wilt be friends. Be friends, and thou wilt not. Why then be enemies with me too? Prithee, put up.
I shall have the 8 shillings I want of you at betting.
A noble shalt thou have, and present pay, and liquor likewise will I give to thee, and friendship shall combine, and brotherhood. Give me thy hand.
I shall have my noble.
In cash most justly paid.
Well then, that's the humor of it.
As ever you came of a woman, come quick to Sir John. Ah, poor heart. He is so shaken of a burning quotidian tertian that is most lamentable to behold. Sweet men, come to him.
The king hath run bad humors upon the knight, and that's the even of it.
Nim, thou hast spoken well. His heart is fracted and corroborate.
The king is a good king, but it must be as it may. He passes of humors and careers.
Let us kindle the knight. For lambkins, we will live.
The king is set from London, and the scene is now transported, gentles, to Southampton. There is your playhouse now. There must you sit, and thence to France shall we convey you safe, and bring you back, charming the narrow seas. To give you gentle pass, for, if we may, we'll not offend one stomach with our play. But till the king come forth, and not till then, and to Southampton do we shift our scene.
Prithee, honey, sweet husband, let me bring thee to Staines.
Boy, bristle thy courage up, for Falstaff is dead, and we must earn therefore.
Would I were with him, where are some he is, either in heaven or in hell?
Nay, sure, he is not in hell, he is in Arthur's bosom. If ever a man went to Arthur's bosom, he made a finer end and went away, and it had been any Christian child. He parted even just between 12 and 1, even at the turning of the tide. For after I saw him fumble with the sheets and play with the flowers and smile upon his fingers' ends, I knew there was but one way, for his nose was as sharp as a pen, and he babbled of green fields. How now, Sir John, quoth I, what man be of good cheer? So he cried out, God, 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 3 or 4 times, and I, to comfort him, bid him not think of God. I hope there is no need of such thoughts yet. And he bade me lay more clothes upon his feet. I put my hand into the bed and felt them, and they were as cold as stone. And then I felt to his knees, and they were as cold as stone, and so upward, and all was as cold as stone.
They say he cried out of sack.
Aye, that he did.
And of women.
Nay, that he did not.
Aye, that he did, and said they were devils incarnate.
He could never abide incarnation, 'twas a color he never liked.
Shall we shock? The king will be gone from Southampton.
Come, let us away. My love, give me thy lips. Look to my chattels and my movables. Go clear thy crystals, yoke fellows in arms. Let us to France, like horse leeches, my boys. To suck, the very blood to suck.
And that's but unwholesome food, they say.
Farewell, hostess.
I cannot kiss, that is the humor of it, but adieu.
Let housewifery appear. Keep close, I thee command.
Farewell, adieu.
Thus comes the English with full power upon us, and more than carefully does concern stands it royally in our defense. And you, Prince Dauphin, with all quick dispatch, to line and new repair our towns of war, with men of courage and means of defendant. For England his approach makes as fierce as water to the sucking of a gulf.
My most redoubted father, it is most meet we arm us against the foe, for peace itself should not so dull a kingdom. The war, nor no known quarrel were in question, but defenses, musters, preparations, should be maintained, assembled, and collected, as were one expectation. Therefore I say, to the moon we go forth, to the sick and feeble parts of France, and let us do it with no show of fear, no more than if we heard that England were busy with the wits and morris dance. For, my good liege, she is so idly kinged, her scepter so fantastically borne, by vain, giddy, shallow, humorous youth, that fear tends her not.
Oh, peace, Prince Dauphin, you are too much mistaken in his king. Question your grace to late ambassadors, with what great state he heard their embassy, how well supplied with noble counselors, how modest in exception, and withal, how terrible in constant resolution. And you shall find all of his vanities forespent, were but the outside of a Roman Brutus, covering discretion with a coat of folly. As gardeners do with ordure, hide those roots, that shall first spring and become most delicate.
Well, 'tis not so, my lord high constable, but though we think it so, it is no matter. In cases of defense, 'tis best to wear the enemy more mighty than he seems.
We think King Harry strong.
Take up the English short and let them know what a monarch you are at head. Self-love, my liege, is not so vile a sin as self-neglecting.
From our brother England?
From him, and thus he greets your majesty. He wills you in the name of God Almighty, that you divest yourself and lay apart from the borrowed glories, that by gift of heaven, by law of nature and of nations, long to him and to his heirs, namely the crown, and all the widespread honors that do pertain, by custom and ordinance of times. unto the crown of France. He bids you then resign your crown and kingdom.
Or else what follows?
Bloody constraint. For if you hide the crown, even in your hearts, there will he rake for it. In a fierce tempest he is coming, and thunder and an earthquake, like a Job, that, if requiring fail, he will compel. This is his message, my message, unless the dolphin be in presence here, to whom expressly I bring greeting to.
For us, we'll consider of this further. Tomorrow shall you bear a full intent back to our brother England.
For the dolphin, I stand here for him. What's him from England?
Scorn, defiance, slight regard, contempt, and anything that may not misbecome the mighty sender doth he prize you at.
Say, if my father render fair return, it is against my will, for I desire nothing but odds with England. To that end, as matching with his youth and vanity, I did present him with Paris balls.
He'll make your Paris Louvre shake for it, and be assured you'll find a difference, as we, his subjects, have in wonder found, between the promise of his greener days. Now he weighs time, even to the utmost grain, that you shall reap your own losses, if you stay in France.
Tomorrow shall you bear a full intent back to our brother England.
Thus, with imagined wing, our swift scene flies in motion of no less celerity than that of thought.
Suppose that you have seen the well-appointed king at Hampton Pier, embark his royalty, and his brave fleet, with silken streamers the young Phoebus fanning. Play with your fancies, and in them behold upon hempen tackle shipways climbing. Hear the shrill whistle which doth order give to sands confused. Behold the threatened sails, borne with the invisible and creeping wind. Draw the huge bottoms through the furrowed seas, breasting the lofty surge. Oh, do you but think, you stand upon a ravage, and behold, a city on the inconstant billows dancing. For so appears the sweet majestical, holding due course to Harfleur. Follow, follow, grapple your minds to the sternage of this navy. Work, work your thoughts, and therein see a siege. Behold the ordnance of their carriages, with fatal mouths, gaping, ungirded Harfleur.
Suppose the ambassador from the French comes back, tells Harry that the king doth offer him Catherine, his daughter, and with her to dowry some petty and unprofitable dukedoms. The offer likes not, and the nimble gunner with linstock now the devilish cannon touches. And all goes down before them. Still be kind, and eke out our performance with your mind.
Once more unto the breach, dear friends, once more, or close up the wall with our English dead. In peace, there's nothing so becomes a man as modest stillness and humility. But when the blast of war blows in our ears, then imitate the action of the tiger. Yeah! Stiffen the sinews, summon up the blood, disguise fair nature with hard-favored rage. Then lend the eye a terrible aspect. I see you stand like greyhounds in the slips, straining upon the start. The game's afoot. Follow your spirit, and upon this charge cry, God for Harry!
God!
England!
England!
And St. George!
And St. George! Ah!
Ah!
And on, to the breach.
Prithee, Corporal, stay, the notch is too hot, and for mine own part, I have not the case of lives. The humor of it is too hot, and that's the very plain song of it.
The plain song is most just, for humors do abound. Knox, go and come, God's vassals drop and die. The sword and shield in the bloody field doth win immortal fame.
Would I were in an alehouse in London, I would give all my fame for a pot of ale and safety.
And I imitate the actions of a tiger. Meow.
Up to the breach, you dogs!
To the breach, you dogs!
Ah!
Be merciful, great duke, to men of milder mold. Abate thy rage, great duke.
Not up to the breach.
These be good humors, your honor, with bad humors.
Up to the breach.
Boy, I observe these three swashers. I am boy to them all three. But to all they three, though they would serve me, could not be man to me. For indeed, three such antics do not amount to a man. For Bardolph, he is white-livered and red-faced. For Pistol, he hath a killing tongue and a quiet sword. For Nim, he hath heard men of few words are the best men, and therefore he scorns to say his prayers. Lest it should be thought a coward. But as few bad words are matched with as few good deeds. They will steal anything and call it purchase. I must leave them and seek some better service. Their villainy goes against my weak stomach, and therefore I must cast it.
Captain Fluellen, you must come presently to the mines. The Duke of Gloucester would speak to you.
To the mines? Tell you the Duke. It is not so good to come to the mines. For look you, the mines is not according to the disciplines of the wars. The concavities of it is not sufficient.
The Duke of Gloucester, to whom the order of the siege is given, is presently directed by an Irishman. A very valiant gentleman, I think.
He is Captain MacMorris, is it not?
I think it be.
He is an ass. He has no more directions in the true disciplines of the wars, look you, of the Roman disciplines, than is a puppy dog.
The town sounds a parley.
When there is more better opportunity to be required, look you, I will be so bold as to tell you that I know the disciplines of the war, and there is an end.
How yet resolves the governor of the town? This is the latest parley we will admit, and to our best mercy give yourselves, or like to men, proud of destruction. Defy us to our worst, for, as I am a soldier, if I begin the battery once again, I will not leave the half-achieved hearth floor till in her ashes she lie buried. The gates of mercy shall be all shut up. What is it to me when you yourselves are cause? We may as bruteless spend our vain command upon the enraged soldiers as send precepts to the Leviathan to come ashore. What say you? Will you yield and this avoid, or guilty in defense, be thus destroyed?
Our expectation hath this day an end. The Dauphin, whom of succor is re-entreated, returns us that his powers are yet not ready. We yield our town and lives to thy soft mercy. Enter our gates, dispose of us in ours, for we are no longer defensible.
Come, Uncle Exeter, go you and enter our floor. There remain and fortify it strongly against the French. Use mercy to them all. Tonight in our floor we will be your guest, and on tomorrow for the march are we addressed.
You have been to England, and you speak the language well.
A little, madame.
I pray thee, teach me, for I must learn to speak. What do you call the hand in English?
The hand is called the hand.
The hand. And the fingers?
The fingers, by my faith, I forget the fingers. But I will remember, the fingers. I think they're called the fingeries. Yes, the fingeries.
The hand, the hand. The fingers, the fingeries. I think I am a good student. I have quickly gained 2 words of English. What do you call the nails?
The nails, we call them denials.
Denials. Listen, tell me if I speak well. De hand, de fingeries, and denials.
Tis well said, madame. It is very good English.
Tell me the English for the arm.
The arm, madame.
And the elbow?
The elbow.
The elbow. I sure repeat all the words that you have taught me thus far.
It is too difficult, madame, I think.
Excuse me, Alice. Listen. De hand, de fingeries, de nails, de arma, de bilbo.
De elbow, madame.
Oh, gracious sakes, I forgot. De elbow. What do you call the neck?
De neek, madame.
De neek. And the chin?
De seen.
De seen. The neck, de neek. The chin de sin.
Yes, by your leave. You pronounce the words as properly as the natives of England.
I do not doubt to learn by the grace of God and in little time.
Have you already forgotten that which I have taught you?
No. Listen. De hand, de fingeries, de nails, de arm, de elbow.
Yeah, by your leave. De elbow.
That's what I said. De elbow. Now also, de neek and de seen. What do you call the toes, the shoes, and the gown?
The little piggies, madame. The heels of height. And the dregs.
The little piggies. The heels of height and the dregs. Oh, Lord in heaven, these are terrible words. Bad, hard, harsh, corrupt, gross, impudent, and not for ladies of honor to use. I do not wish to pronounce these words before the lords of France for all the world. Foe to little piggies and the dregs. Nonetheless, I will recite once more my lesson altogether. De hand, de fingeries, de nails, de arm, de ilbu, de neek, de sin, de little piggies, de heels of height, and de dregs.
Excellent, madame.
That is enough for one time. Let us to dinner.
'Tis certain he hath passed the river Salm.
Do they betiles? Where have they this metal? Is not their climate foggy, raw, and dull? Assume as in this spite the sun looks pale, killing their fruit with frowns?
By faith and honor our madams mock at us, and plainly say our metal is burnt out.
Where is Montour the herald? Speed him hence. Let him greet England with our sharp defiance. Up, princes, and with spirit of honor edged, more sharper than your swords, high to the field. Bar, hairy England, that sweeps through our land, with pinions painted in blood of her fear. Go down upon him, you have power enough, and in a captive chariot into Rouen, bring him our prisoner.
This becomes the great. Sorry am I his numbers are so few, his soldiers sick and famished from their march. For I am sure when he shall see our army, he shall drop his heart into the sink of fear, and for achievement offer us his ransom.
Therefore, Lord Constable, haste on, Montjoy. Let him say to England that we send to know what willing ransom he will give. Prince Dauphin, you stay with us in Rome.
Not so, I do beseech your majesty.
Be patient, for you shall remain with us. Now forth, Lord Constable, and princes all, and quickly bring us word of England's fall.
Take control of the bridge, Uncle Exeter. The rest of the army will march at dawn.
Men, to the bridge!
So tired. Need water. Need water. Water? Water. Water.
Thank you.
How dare you!
Not him again.
To the bridge, you knave! Were you not up to the bridge? Say, goaty, beef-minded, blockhead!
Men, arrest him. Take him to the gallows.
I didn't do it! God, put me down! I didn't do it!
I assure you, there is very excellent services committed at the bridge.
Is the Duke of Exeter safe?
The Duke of Exeter is as magnanimous as Agamemnon, and a man that I love and honor with my soul and my heart and my duty and my life and my living and my uttermost power. He keeps the bridge most valiantly with excellent discipline. There is an ancient lieutenant there at the bridge. I think in my conscience he is as valiant a man as Mark Antony.
What do you call him?
He is called Ancient Pistol.
I know him not.
Here is the man.
Captain, I thee beseech to do me favors. The Duke of Exeter doth love thee well.
Aye, praise God, and I have merited some love at his hands.
Bardolph a soldier, firm and sound of heart. He has stolen pax, and hanging must he be. A damn of death, let gallows gate for dogs, let man go free. But Exeter, he hath given the doom of death for pax little price. Therefore, go speak, the Duke will hear thy voice. And let not Bardolph's vital thread be cut with edge of penny cord and vile reproach. Speak, Captain, for his life, for I will thee requite.
Ancient Pistol, I do partly understand thy meaning.
Why then rejoice, therefore?
Certainly, Ancient, it is not a thing to rejoice at. For, look you, if he were my brother, I would desire the Duke to use his good pleasure and put him to execution, for discipline ought to be used.
Thine be damned! The figure for thy friendship!
It is well.
The fig of Spain.
Very good.
Was this the man you were talking about?
No, not that one.
It's
Why, this is an errant counterfeit rascal. I remember him now, a bald cut purse.
Hark you, the king is coming, and I must speak with him from the bridge. God bless your majesty.
How now, Llewellyn? Camest thou from the bridge?
The Duke of Exeter has very gallantly maintained the bridge. Yeah! The French has gone off, look you, and there is gallant and most brave passages.
What have you lost, Llewellyn?
Mary, for my part, I think the Duke hath lost ne'er a man, but one like to be executed for robbing a church. One Bardolph, if your majesty know his name. His face is all bubucles and whelks and knobs and flames of fire. But his nose is executed, and his fire is out.
We would have all such offenders so cut off, and we give express charge that in our marches through the country there be nothing compelled from the villages, nothing taken but paid for. For when lenity and cruelty play for a kingdom, the gentler gamester is the soonest winner.
You know me by my habit.
Well, what shall I know of thee?
My master's mind.
Unfold it.
Thus says my king, say thou to Harry of England, though we seem dead, we did but sleep. Advantage is a better soldier than rashness. Tell him we could have rebuked him at Harfleur, but we thought not good to bruise an injury till we were full ripe. Now we speak upon our cue, and our voice is imperial. England shall repent his folly, see his weakness, and admire our sufferance. Bid him therefore to consider his ransom, and to this add defiance, and tell him, for conclusion, that he hath betrayed his followers, whose condemnation is pronounced, so much my king and master, so much my office.
I know thy quality. What is thy name?
Mountjoy.
Thou dost thy office fairly. Turn thee back and tell thy king I do not seek him now, but could be willing to march on to Calais without impeachment. For, to say the sooth, 'tis no wisdom to confess so much unto an enemy of craft and vantage. My people are with sickness much enfeebled, and my numbers lessened. And those few I have, no better than so many French, who, when they were in health, I tell thee, Harold, I thought upon one pair of English legs did drive three Frenchmen. Yet, forgive me, God, that I do brag thus. This your heir of France hath blown that vice in me. I must repent. Go therefore and tell thy king, here I am. My ransom is this frail and worthless trunk, my army but a weak and sickly guard. Therefore, tell your king we will come on, though France and such a neighbor stand in our way. There's for thy labor, Mountjoy. The sum of all our answer is but this. We would not seek a battle as we are, nor as we are, we say we will not shun it. So tell your master.
I shall deliver so, thanks to your highness.
I hope they will not come upon us now.
We are in God's hand, brother, not in theirs. March to the bridge, it now draws toward night. Beyond the river we'll encamp ourselves, and on tomorrow bid them march away.
Tut, I have the best armor of the world. What or day?
You have an excellent armor, but let my horse have his due.
It is the best horse of Europe.
Will it never be morning?
My lord of Orleans, my lord high constable, you talk of horse and armor?
You are as well provided of both as any prince in the world.
Will it never be day? I will not change my horse with any that treads but on four pasterns. When I bestride him, I soar. I am a hawk. He trots the air. The air sings when he touches it.
He is the color of nutmeg.
And of the heat of the ginger.
Indeed, my lord. It is the most absolute and excellent horse.
It is the Prince of Palfreys. His neigh is like the bidding of a monarch, and his countenance enforces homage.
No more, cousin.
Nay, the man hath no wit that cannot. From the rising of the lark to the lodging of the lamb, a very deserved praise on my palfrey. It is a theme as fluent as the sea. I once heard a sonnet in his praise, and it began thus, wonder of nature.
I have heard a sonnet begin so, to one's mistress.
Then did they imitate that which I composed to my horse.
You have good judgment and horsemanship.
Will it never be day? I will trot tomorrow a mile, and my way shall be paved with English faces.
I would it were morning, for I would fain be about the ears of the English.
Tis midnight, I'll go arm myself.
The Dauphin longs for morning.
He longs to eat the English. I think he'll eat all that he kills.
He is simply the most active gentleman of France.
Doing his activity, he will still be doing.
He never did harm, that I heard of.
Nor will do none tomorrow. He will keep that good name still.
I know him to be valiant.
I was told that by one who knows better than you.
What's he?
Mary, he told me so himself, and he cares not who knew it.
He needs not. It is no hidden virtue in him.
A valiant and most expert gentleman. Would it were day. Alas, poor Harry of England cares not for the dawning as we do. Now, is it time to arm? Come, shall we be about it?
It is now 2 o'clock, but let me see. By 10, we shall each have 100 Englishmen.
Now entertain conjecture of a time when creeping murmur and pouring dark fill the wide vessel of the universe. From camp to camp, through the foul womb of night, the hum of either army's silly sounds, that the fixed sentinels almost receive the secret whispers of each other's watch. The country cocks do crow, the clocks do toll, and the third hour of drowsy morning name.
But now, who will behold the royal captain of this ruined band, walking from watch to watch, from tent to tent. Let him cry, praise and glory on his head, for forth he goes and visits all his hosts.
The poor condemned English like sacrifices by watchful fires sit patiently and inly ruminate the morning's danger.
Proud of their numbers and secure in soul, the confident and overlusty French do the low-rated English play at dice.
And now our scene must to the battle fly, O name of Agincourt, yet sit and see, minding true things by what their mockeries be.
Qui va là? Discuss unto me, art thou officer or art thou base? Common and popular.
I am a gentleman of a company. What art thou?
As good a gentleman as the emperor.
Then you are better than the king.
The king is a bawcock and a heart of gold. I kiss his dirty shoe, and from heartstrings, I love the lovely bully. What is thy name?
Harry Leroy.
Leroy. A Cornish name. Art thou of Cornish crew?
No, I am a Welshman.
Knowest thou Fluellen?
Yes.
Tell him I'll knock a leak upon his pate upon St. Davy's Day.
Do not you wear a dagger in your cap that day, lest he knock that about yours.
What, are you his friend?
And his kinsman too.
The figgle for thee then.
I thank you, God be with you.
My name's Pistol called.
It sorts well with your fierceness.
Captain Fluellen!
So, by Jesus, you speak lower. It's the greatest folly in the universal world when the true and ancient prerogatives and the laws of the wars is not kept. If you would take the pains but to examine the wars of Pompey the Great, you shall find, I warrant you, that there is no tittle-tattle nor pibble-pabble in Pompey's camp.
Why? The enemy is loud. You can hear him all night.
If the enemy is an ass and a fool and a prating coxcomb, is it meet, think you, that we also, look you, should be an ass and a fool and a prating coxcomb in your conscience now?
I will speak lower.
I pray you and beseech you that you will.
Though it appear a little out of fashion, there is much care and valor in this Welshman.
Brother John Bates, is that not the morning which breaks yonder?
I think it be, but we have no great cause to desire the approach of day.
We see yonder the beginning of the day, but I never think we shall see the end of it.
Who goes there?
A friend.
Under which captain serve you?
Under Sir Thomas Erpingham.
A good old commander and a most kind gentleman. I pray you, what thinks he of our estate?
Even as men, wrecked upon the sand, they look to be washed off the next tide.
He hath not told his thought to the king?
No, nor is it meet that he should, for though I speak to you, I think the king is but a man, as I am. The violet smells to him as it doth to me. The element shows to him as it doth to me. And when he sees reasons of fears as we do, his fears, out of doubt, be of the same relish as ours are. Yet, in reason, no man should possess him with any appearance of fear, lest he, by showing it, should disarden his army.
He may show what outward courage he will, but I believe, a cold night as 'tis, he could wish himself to Thames up to the neck. So, would I were he were, and I by him, at all adventures, so we were quit here.
By my troth, I will speak my conscience of the king. I think he would not wish himself anywhere but where he is.
Then I would he were here alone, so should he be sure to be ransomed and of many a poor man's life saved.
I dare say you love him not so ill. However so, you speak this to feel other men's minds. I think I could not die anywhere so contented as in the king's company, his cause being just and his quarrel honorable.
That's more than we know.
Aye, or more than we should seek after, for we know enough. If we know we are the king's subjects, if his cause be wrong, our obedience to the king wipes the crime of it out of us.
But if the cause be not good, the king himself hath a heavy reckoning to make. When all those legs and arms and heads chopped off in battle shall join together at a latter day and cry all, we died in such a place. Now if these men do not die well, it will be a black matter for the king that led them into it, whom to disobey were against all proportion of subjection.
So if a son that is sent by his father upon merchandise doth sinfully miscarry upon the sea, the imputation of his wickedness by your rule should be imposed on the father then sent him. But this is not so. The king is not to answer the particular endings of his soldiers, the father of his son, nor the master of his servant, for they purpose not their death when they purpose their services.
'Tis certain that every man that dies ill, the ill upon his own head, the king is not to answer it.
Aye, but I do not desire he should answer for me, yet I determine to fight lustily for him.
I myself heard the king say he would not be ransomed.
Aye, he said so, to make us fight cheerfully. But when our throats are cut, he may be ransomed, and we are near the wiser.
If I live to see it, I'll never trust this word after.
You may as well go about to turn the sun to ice by fanning his face with a peacock's feather. You'll never trust his word after? Come, 'tis a foolish saying.
Your proof is something too round. I should be angry with you if the time were right.
Let it be a quarrel between us, if you live.
I embrace it.
How shall I know thee again?
Give me any gage of thine, and I will wear it in my bonnet. And if thou ever darest acknowledge it, I will make it my quarrel.
Here is my glove.
Be friends, you English fools, be there. Friends. We have French quarrels now, if you could tell how to reckon.
Upon the king? Let us our lives, our souls, our debts, our careful wives, sins lay on the king? We must bear all. O hard condition, O God of battle, steel my soldiers' hearts. Possess them not with fear. Take from them now that sense of reckoning. If the opposed numbers pluck their hearts from them. Not today, O Lord, O not today. Think upon the fault my father made, encompassing the crown. I Richard's body have interred anew, and on it have bestowed more contrite tears than from it issued forced drops of blood. More will I do, yet all I can do is nothing worth, since that my penitence comes after all, imploring pardon. I know thy of thee. The day, my friends, and all things stay for me.
The sun doth gild our armor. Up, my lords!
Monte a cheval, my horse. Ha! Now, my lord constable.
Hark! How are steeds for present service today?
Mount them and make incision in their hides, that their hot blood may spin in English eyes, and doubt them with superfluous courage. Ha!
To horse, ye gallant princes, straight to horse. Do but behold yon poor and starved band, and your fair shells shall suck away their souls, leaving them but the shales and the husks of men.
Shall I send them dinners and fresh suits, and feed their starving horses provender and after fight with them?
I will the banner from a trumpet take, and use it for my haste. Come, come away. The sun is high, and we are the way of the day.
Ah!
Where is the king?
The king himself is rode to view their battle.
A fighting men, they have full 60,000.
There's 5 to 1. Besides, they all are fresh.
God's arms strike with us. 'Tis a fearful odds.
Oh, that we now had here but 10,000 of those men in England that do no work today.
What's he that wishes so? My cousin Westmoreland? No, my fair cousin. If we are marked to die, we are now to do our country loss. And if to live, the fewer men, the greater share of honor. God's will, I pray thee, wish not one man more. No faith, my cause, wish not a man from England. God's peace, I would not lose so great an honor as one man more methinks would share for me, for the best hope I have. Rather, proclaim it, Westmoreland, through my host, that he which hath no stomach to this fight, let him depart. His passport shall be made, and crowns for convoy put into his purse. We would not die in that man's company, that fears his fellowship to die with us. This day is called the Feast of Crispian. He that lives this day and comes safe home will stand a tiptoe when the day is named and say, tomorrow is Saint Crispian. Then will he strip his sleeve and show his scars and say, these wounds I had on Crispian's day. Old men forget, it all shall be forgot, but he'll remember with advantages what feats he did that day. Then shall our names, familiar in his mouth as household words, be in their cups freshly remembered. This story shall the good man teach his son, and Crispian shall ne'er go by from this day to the ending of the world, but we in it shall be remembered. We few, we happy few, we band of brothers, for he today that sheds his blood with me shall be my brother, be he ne'er so vile, this day shall gentle his condition. And gentlemen in England now abed shall think themselves accursed they were not here, and hold their manhoods cheap, whiles any speaks that fought with us upon St. Crispin's Day!
Ah! My sovereign lord, bestow yourself with speed. The French are bravely in their battle sets, and will, with all expedience, charge on us.
All things are ready, if our minds be so.
Perish the man whose mind is backward now.
Thou dost not wish more help from England, cuz?
God's will, my liege, would you and I alone, without more help, could fight this royal battle.
Why, now thou hast unwished 5,000 men, that likes me better than to wish us one. You know your places. God be with you all!
Once more I come to know of thee, King Harry, if for thy ransom thou wilt not compound before thy most assured overthrow.
Who has sent thee
now? The Constable of France.
I pray thee, bear my former answer back. Bid them achieve me, and then sell my bones. Good God, why should they mock poor fellows thus? The man that once did sell the lion skin, while the beast lived, was killed with hunting him. Let me speak proudly. We are but warriors for the working day. Our gayness and our guilt are all besmirched with rainy marching in the painful field. Harold, save thou thy labor. Come thou no more for ransom, gentle Harold. They shall have none, I swear, but these my joints, in which they have as I shall leave them, shall yield them little. So tell the constable.
I shall, King Harry. Thou shalt never, and so fare thee well. Thou shalt never hear Harold any more.
Now, soldiers, march away, and how thou pleasest God, dispose the day.
First, go.
Oh, diable!
Oh, senor, légeur, et perdu, tu es perdu.
Mort de ma vie, all is confounded, all reproach and everlasting shame sits mocking in our plumes. Oh, merchant de fortune, do not run away.
Why? All our ranks are broke.
Oh, perdurable shame, let's stab ourselves. Be these just the wretches that we played a dice for?
Is this the king we sent for, to his ransom? We are new, yet living in the field, to smother up the English in our throngs, that any order might be thought upon.
The devil take order now, all to the throng. Let life be short, else shame will be too long.
What have we done, first valiant countrymen? But all's not done, yet keep the French the field.
The Duke of York commends him to your majesty.
Lives he, good uncle? Thrice within this hour I saw him down, and thrice up in fighting, from helm to spur, all blood he was.
In which array, brave soldier, doth he lie, larding the plain? And by his bloody side, yoke fellow, to his honoring wounds, the noble Earl of Suffolk also lies. Soho first died, and York all haggled over. The pretty and sweet manner of it forced those waters from me, which I would have stopped if I had but of a man in me. And all my mother came into mine eyes and gave me up to tears.
I blame you not. For hearing this, I must perforce compound with misful eyes, or they will issue too. But hark, what new alarm is the same? The French have reinforced their scattered men. Come, we must defend the English forces.
Thank you.
boys in the luggage. It is expressly against the law of arms. Aye, he was born at Monmouth, Captain Gower. What call you the name of the town where Alexander the Pig was born? Why, I pray, is Pig not great? The Pig, or the Great, or the Mighty, or the Huge, or the Magnanimous? All are one reckonings, save the phrase is a little variations.
Alexander the Great was born at Mastow. His father was called Philip of Mastow, as I think.
I'll tell you good men are born at Monmouth, as good as are at Macedon.
Here comes his majesty.
I was not angry since I came from France until this instant. Take a trumpet, herald, ride unto the horsemen on yon hill. If they avoid with us, bid them come down. Avoid the field, for they do offend our sight. Go tell them so.
Here comes the herald of the French, my liege. His eyes are humbler than they used to be.
How now? What means this, herald? Dost thou know that I find these bones of mine for ransom? Hast thou come again for ransom?
No, great king. I come to thee for charitable license, that we may wander o'er this bloody field to look our dead and then to bury them, to sort our nobles from our common men. Oh, give us leave, great king, to view this field in safety and dispose of their dead bodies.
I tell thee truly, herald, I know not if the day is ours or no, yet so many of your horsemen peer and gallop o'er the field.
The day is yours.
Ha!
Then praise be God, and not our strength for it. What is the castle called that stands hard by?
They call it Agincourt.
Then call we this the field of Agincourt, fought on the day of Crispin Crispianus.
Your grandfather, of most famous memory, an it please your majesty, and your great uncle, Edward, the Black Prince of Wales, fought a most brave battle here in France.
They did, Llewellyn.
Your majesty says very true, and if your majesty's is remembered of it, the Welshmen did a good service in a garden where leeks did grow, wearing leeks in their Monmouth caps, which, your majesty know, to this hour is an honorable badge of the service. And I do believe your majesty takes no scorn in wearing the leek upon St. Tavy's Day.
I wear it for a memorable honor, for I am Welsh, you know, a good countryman. Call yonder fellow hither.
Soldier, you must come to the king.
Soldier, why wearest thou that glove in thy cap?
And please, your majesty, 'tis the gage of one that I should fight withal, if he be alive.
An Englishman.
And please, your majesty, a rascal that swayed with me last night. If he be alive and ever dare to challenge this glove, I have sworn to take him a box o'er the ear.
What think you, Llewellyn? Is it fit this soldier keep his oath?
He is a craven and a villain else, and please, your majesty, in my conscience.
Then keep thy vow, sirrah, when thou meetest the fellow.
I will as I live, my liege.
Who servest thou under?
Under Captain Gower, my liege.
Call him hither to me.
I will, my liege.
Llewellyn, take this, the glove of a lenchon.
A word in thy cap.
For a favor, knowest thou Gower?
He is my dear friend, an it please your majesty.
I pray thee, go seek him and bring him to my tent.
I will fetch him, your loveliness.
Exeter, follow Llewellyn closely at the heels, for the glove which I have given him as a favor may happily purchase him a box o' the ear. It is a soldier's. I, by bargain, should wear it myself. Follow, good cousin Warwick. As if the soldier should strike him by his blunt bearing, he should keep his word. Some sudden mischief may arise from it. Go and see there be no harm done between them.
I warrant it is tonight, you captain.
God's will and his good pleasure, captain. I beseech you, come apace to the king. There's more good toward you peradventure than is in your knowledge to dream of.
Sir, know you this glove?
Know the glove? I know the glove is glove.
I know this, and thus I challenge it.
Splied! As errant a traitor as any in the universal world, or in France, or in England.
How now, sir, you villain!
Do you think?
think I'll be forsworn?
Stand away, Captain Gower. Treason!
I am no traitor!
There's a lie in thy throat. I charge you in his majesty's name.
Your majesty, here is a villain and a traitor. That, look, your grace, has struck the glove which your majesty's take out of the helmet of Alençon.
My liege, this is my glove, and here is the fellow of it. And he that I gave it to in change promised to wear it in his cap, and I promised to strike him if he did. I met this man with my glove in his cap, and I have been as good as my word.
Your majesty, hear now. Is not this the glove of Alençon which your majesty has given me? And your conscience now.
Soldier, give me your glove. Look, here is the fellow of it. It was I indeed thou promised to strike, and thou hast given me most bitter terms.
And please, your majesty, let his neck answer for it.
How canst thou make me satisfaction?
All offense, my lord, came from the heart. Never came name from mine that might offend your majesty.
It was ourself thou didst abuse.
Your majesty came not like yourself. You came to me, but as a common man. Witness the night, your garments, your lowliness, and what your highness suffered under that shape. I beseech you, take it for your own fault, not mine. For had you been as I took you for, I made no offense. Therefore, I beseech you, pardon me.
Exeter, take this glove and fill it with crowns, and give it to the fellow. Fellow, take it, and wear it in thy cap for an honor until I do challenge him. Exeter, give him the crowns. And captain, thou must needs be friends with him.
By this day and by this light, the fellow has metal enough in his belly. Hold, here's 12 pence for you.
I will have none of your money.
It is with a good will. It will serve you to mend your shoes. Come now, wherefore should you be so bashful? Your shoes is not so good. 'Tis a good shilling, I warned you, or else I will change it.
Now, Fuellen, are the dead numbered?
Here's the number of the slaughtered French.
Are any prisoners of good sort taken, uncle?
Full 1,500, besides common men.
This note doth tell me of 10,000 French that in the field lie slain. This was a royal fellowship of death. But where is the number of our English dead? Edward, Duke of York, the Earl of Suffolk, Sir Richard Kettley, Davy Gam. None of some name, but 25. O Lord, thine arm was here, and not to us, but thine arm alone. Ascribe we all, when without stratagem, but in plain shot, can even play a battle, was known, so great and little loss, on one side and on the other. Take it, God, for it is none but thine.
'Tis wonderful.
Come, go we in procession to the village, and may it be death proclaimed through our hosts. To boast of this, or take praise from God, which is his only, do we all holy rites. Then let there be sung Non Nimis and Tu Deum, the dead with charity buried in clay. Then to Calais, and to England then, whene'er from France arrived more happy men.
Safe to those who have not read the story, that I may prompt them. And of such as have, I humbly pray them to admit the excuse of time, of number, and of due course of things, which cannot in their huge proper life be here presented. Now we bear the king toward Calais, grant him there is seen, heave him away upon our winged thoughts athwart the sea, and thus so let him land, and solemnly see him set on to London, so swift a pace have thought that even now, you may imagine him upon Blackheath, where that his lords desire him to have borne his bruised helmet and bended sword before him through the city. He forbids it, being free from vainness and self-glorious pride, giving full trophy, signal, and ostent, quite from himself to God.
But now behold, how London doth pour out her citizens, as yet the lamentations of the French invite the King of England to stay at home. The Emperor's coming in behalf of France to order peace between them, and amid all the occurrences, whatever chance, till Harry's back return again to France. There must we bring him, and myself have played the interim by remembering you 'tis past. Then book her abridgment, and your eyes advance, after your thoughts, straight back again to France.
Meeting, wherefore we are met, unto our brother France, into our sister, health and fair time of day, enjoying good wishes to our fair and most princely cousin Catherine.
Right joyous are we to behold your face, most worthy brother England fairly met, and you, princes English, every one.
My duty to you both, on equal love, great kings of France and England, that I have labored, with all my wits, my pains, and strong endeavors, to bring your most imperial majesties unto this bar and royal interview, your mightiness on both parts best can witness. Since then my office has so far prevailed, that face to face and royal eye to eye you have congreed, let it not disgrace me. If I demand before this royal view, what rub or what impediment there is, why the naked, poor, and mangled peace, dear nurse of arts and joyful births, should not in this best garden of the world, our fertile France, put up her lovely visage? Alas, she hath from France too long been chased, and all her husbandry doth lie in heaps, corrupting its own fertility. And as our vineyards, fallows, meads, and hedges, defective in their natures, grow to wildness, which to not reduce our former favor, but grow like even so our houses and ourselves and children have lost. Or do not learn for want of time. The sciences that should become our country, but grow like savages. Which to reduce in our former favor and bless us with our former qualities.
If, Duke of Burgundy, you would, the peace, which want gives growth to the imperfections which you have cited, you must first buy the peace with full accord to all our just demands.
The king hath heard them, to which as yet there is no answer made.
Well then, the peace, which be so urged, lies in his answer.
I have but with a cursory eye or glance the articles. Pleaseth your grace to appoint some of your council presently to sit with us once more. With better heed, we will resurvey them. We will suddenly pass or accept and promontory answer.
Brother, we shall. Go, Uncle Exeter, and take with you free power to ratify, augment, and alter, till thy wisdom best shall see. But leave our cousin Catherine here thus. She is our capital demand, comprised in the forerank of our articles.
She hath good leave.
Fair Catherine, and most fair, we vouchsafe to teach a soldier terms that will enter a lady's ear and plead his love suit to her gentle heart.
Your Majesty shall mock at me. I cannot speak your England.
Faith, Kate, if you love me soundly with your French heart, I'll be glad to hear you confess it brokenly in your English tongue. Do you like me, Kate?
Pardonnez-moi. I cannot tell what is like me.
An angel is like you, Kate. You are like an angel.
What did he say? That I resemble the angels? Save your grace, he said.
Yes, I said so, Kate, and I must not blush to affirm it. Faith, my wooing is fit for thy understanding, and I am glad thou canst speak thus better English. Here, if thou couldst, you take me such a plain king, that I think I sold my farm to buy my crown. I know not how to mention it in love, but to say I love you. So clap hands in the bargain. What say you, lady?
Save your honor, me understand well.
Kate, if you would take such a one, take me, take a soldier, take a soldier, take a king, take a king. What say thou to my love? Speak, my fair and fairly, I pray thee.
Is it possible that I should love the enemy of France?
No, Kate, it's not possible to love the enemy of France, for in loving me, you love the friend of France. For I love France so much that when France is mine, I will not depart from a village of it. I will have it all mine. And when yours is France, and you are mine, then yours is France, and I am yours.
I cannot tell what is that.
No faith, Kate. But canst thou understand thus much English? Canst thou love me?
I cannot tell.
Can your neighbors tell? Come, I'll ask them. I know thou lovest me. What say you, my fair flower de luce?
I do not know that.
No faith, Kate. Break thy mind to me brokenly in your English. Wilt thou have me?
That is as it shall please de Rab mon père.
It will please him, Kate. Yes, it will please him.
Then it shall also content me.
Then here I kiss you and call you my sovereign queen. Here comes your father.
We are agreed on peace.
Shall Kate be my wife?
So please you.
I'm content.
We have consented to all terms of reason.
Is it so, my lords of England?
The king himself has granted every article, his daughter first and then in sequel all, according to their firm proposed natures.
Take her fair son, and from her blood raise up issue to me, that the contending kingdoms of France and England, whose very shores look pale with envy of each other's happiness, may cease their hatred in this dear conjunction, plant neighborhood and Christian-like accord in their sweet bosoms, that never war advance his bleeding sword twixt England and fair France.
Now welcome, Kate, and prepare me for our marriage, and bear me witness all that here I kiss her as my sovereign queen. Prepare me for marriage, where on that day, my lord of Burgundy, will say your oaths for all the peers, for surety of our leagues. And I will swear to Kate, and she to me, and may our oaths be well kept and prosperous be.
Thus far, with rough and all unable pen, our bending author hath pursued his story. In little room, confining mighty men, mangling by starts the full course of their glory. Small time, but in that small most greatly lived this star of England. Fortune made his sword, by which the world's best gardens be achieved, and of it left his son, imperial lord.
Henry VI. In infant bands, crowned king of France and England, did this king succeed, whose state so many had the managing, that they lost France and made his England bleed, which oft our stage hath shown, and, for their sake, in your fair minds, let this acceptance take.
Was last Monday morning,
Oh, as I have heard them say, our orders that came this afternoon, we're bound to march away. While the Lancashire lads have gone abroad, whatever shall we do? They're leaving, many's a pretty fair maid to cry, what shall I do? Said the mother to the daughter, what makes you talk so strange? That you want to marry a soldier lad and the whole wide world to range. While the Lancashire lads have gone abroad, whatever shall we do? They're leaving, many's a pretty fair maid to cry, what shall I do? For the soldiers, they are rambling boys, they have but little pay. Can they maintain a wife and child on 15 pence a day? For the Lancashire lads have gone abroad, whatever shall we do? They're leaving, many's a pretty fair maid to cry, what shall I do? Said the father to the daughter, I'll have you close confined. You'll never marry a soldier lad, he'll be no son of mine. For the Lancashire lads have gone abroad, whatever shall we do? They're leaving, many's a pretty fair maid to cry, what shall I do?